Shield Hero's legendary weapons were somewhat of a mystery throughout the first season. The only things we really knew were that by slaying monsters and absorbing their materials, you could unlock different variants of shields, with each variant granting some form of buff or special ability. In episode 22, some more context on how these weapons worked were given. Each of the heroes explained their own understanding and methods of empowering them. However, each gave an explanation that didn't align with the others. The thing is, the methods they described weren't necessarily wrong. In fact, they were all actually valid, and I'm here to explain how each of them allow Nao Fumi to get stronger. So let's take a look at the details behind how exactly these legendary weapons work. When the behaviors of each weapon was revealed to be unique depending on the hero, Nao Fumi didn't think there was any reason to doubt that. Everyone else seemed to identify a method that they were already familiar with. They even had their own built-in help sections to describe those functions. As for Nao Fumi, no matter where he looked in his menus, he couldn't find anything like that. The section where that information should have been was always blank. Remember, Nao Fumi was the only one out of the four of them who wasn't entirely familiar with the game that seemed to mimic this world. So that was the first hint that perhaps the weapons reflected the heart of its users. Ren, Itsuki, and Motoyasu all had that primary vision of that one game they seemed to be convinced was the game that this world was based off of. Having all come from different backgrounds of VR, MMO, and console gaming, it makes sense why they'd all have different descriptions. The games they were familiar with simply weren't the same as the ones the others were familiar with. So, what mechanics did each of those three heroes envision from those games, and what did their weapons subsequently inherit from it? Well, let's start with Ren. To him, everything was dependent on his level, and level was what determined his strength. There were three key components that related to this level equals strength functionality. The first was mastery. Using the same weapon over and over again would improve his proficiency with it and ultimately increase his mastery level. It's a pretty straightforward concept of getting stronger by grinding levels. It's the other two components that are slightly more unique. Energy transfer and rarity work hand in hand with each other to allow Ren to maximize the power of a specific weapon. Energy transfer operates in a similar manner to the prestige system from Call of Duty, in the sense where when you reach the max mastery level with a weapon, you could reset its level back to zero by releasing all of the energy invested into it. What's this energy I'm talking about? Well, by using a type of sword or absorbing materials, Ren imbues that sword with energy. That energy can stockpile up to a certain point, which in turn increases the rarity level of said weapon. This can go towards unlocking new abilities or even making existing ones more powerful. So, to give you a better picture, imagine this. Let's say Ren just unlocked a new sword type and now wants to make it stronger. He can easily do so without having to go out and hunt monsters. All he needs to do is transfer energy from an existing sword type that already has a decent mastery level on it. By resetting that mastery, he'll be given an inventory item known as energy points, which can be transferred to the sword that he wants, essentially providing a way to max out his weapons without the need to grind. So that's how Ren's sword worked. The only risk associated with this was that if the energy transfer from one weapon to another failed, then both weapons would return back to zero mastery. Next, let's take a look at Motoyasu's spear. In contrast to Ren and his vision of mastery level being everything, Motoyasu believed that everything was dependent on the weapon itself. To him, the base stats of a weapon didn't really matter. It was how you upgraded it after obtaining it that mattered the most. Whether it be physical enhancements or mystical enchantments, Motoyasu made sure to modify his weapons as much as he could. But he had to be careful not to make them unusable, because being able to actually fight with those weapons was determined by his overall strength and experience. So, how does Motoyasu even go about upgrading his weapons in the first place? Well, there are three things he can do to improve their quality. The first would be smelting. By equipping a weapon with a specific ore, he can increase its power and ability, almost like he was combining the material with the weapon itself in order to make it stronger. Though, not all ores are compatible with all weapons. There is a chance that a weapon could reject the ore and end up resetting its own status. So, it was best to verify ore and weapon combinations first. The second method was to use what's called spirit enchantment. Similar to what Nao Fumi's already been doing, pieces of monsters or items can be absorbed by a weapon to imbue them with special powers, which is also in the same vein as the third method called status enchantment. This increases a weapon's stats through that same process of material absorption. Basically, Motoyasu's spear centered on the idea that your individual level didn't really matter. At the end of the day, he could be using the flimsiest looking spear. But if he upgraded it with some diamond strength ores and Ein's Ulgon super tier magic enhancements, then it really didn't matter what the spear looked like. For all we know, under the hood, that spear could be strong enough to cast Lancer's Noble Phantasm, though highly unlikely considering how stupid Motiyasu is. But in the hands of a clever person, I can see this mechanic being used to deceive overconfident opponents. Anyway, so now we've seen Ren focus on level and Motiyasu focus on weapon stats. Once again, unlike those two, Itsuki's focus was more towards a weapon's rarity. This was what he found to be the most important thing. Enhancing a common weapon wouldn't be nearly as useful as obtaining a rare weapon. The two just didn't stack up to each other. Sure, he could power up any weapon using specific ores and boost their stats through item enchantment, but at the end of the day, all of that was just a minor afterthought in comparison to the benefits of using more rare weapons. Now, in addition to the abilities of power-up and item enchantment, Itsuki also has what he refers to as a job level. Basically, he can increase his own individual stats by absorbing monster parts or items. So, rather than absorbing materials to improve his weapons all the time, he can now buff himself instead. In my opinion, this is one of the most useful skills the heroes possess, because being able to improve yourself is far more useful than constantly improving your weapons. Anyway, those were the methods each of the heroes identified as how they made themselves stronger. The thing is, none of them could come to the agreement that the other was right. Each hero was adamant that what they spoke was the truth. Not once did they even consider the possibility that they could all be right, and it's that stubbornness that was holding them back. Now, Fumi himself was no exception to this, but he remembered what he learned from his days of being a merchant. If you're too afraid of being tricked, then you'll always miss the chance to make it big. So, because he didn't even have a solid understanding of his own shield, he saw no harm in at least trying to believe what the others had been saying. It was a leap of faith, but perhaps at least one of the methods could be applied to his shield. He decided to test Itsuki's method first. Staring intently into his shield and believing his words to be true, he opened the shield's menu to find that a new item was listed. It said Power Up. This was the first technique that Naofumi explored. By selecting an ore from his inventory and finding a compatible shield, he was able to test what exactly this power-up mechanic did for him. At first, the Bee Needle shield showed these attributes, but after experimenting with numerous different possible effects, he was able to find a combination of items that could be absorbed by the shield which gave a success rate of 100%. This added a new item enchantment line to his shield's profile. It seemed that every time he repeated the same power-up, the shield's enchantment level would increase, and with it his resistance to Usupil-type monsters, a buff that was likely dependent on the type of ore Naofumi used during the process. The effect given each time is likely subject to change. Anyway, that's pretty much how the power-up mechanic worked. More importantly, the success of this function meant that the other functions should work as well. Alongside this new item enchantment descriptor was another gauge that hadn't moved the entire time. It turned out to be the job level attribute that Itsuki had also mentioned. Clicking into it revealed a large number of statuses, but now Fumi felt the one he should focus on would be defense. This revealed two things, his defense job level and a defense gauge. The gauge was an interactive element that allowed items to be inserted into it. Every monster part put in would increase the gauge level ever so slowly. Once filled, his job level would go up by one, and his base defense stats would increase. It was a process that could be repeated numerous times so long as he had the necessary materials, but doing it over and over again required more each time. It was convenient timing since Naofumi had only recently discovered that his shield had been carrying inventory from literally every monster he had ever slain. Ever since he came to this world, monster drops had been automatically picked up and stored for later use, meaning there were all types of materials Naofumi already had in his possession with which he could use to experiment on his job level. If not to increase his defenses, he could surely put those materials to use in another type of job class. With this, Naofumi got the gist of how Itsuki's method affected his shield. Next would be to test out Ren's system. He made sure to believe in how level determined his strength, and sure enough, the mastery level for his shields appeared. Looking at his favorite shield, the Chimera Viper shield displayed this. It was already at max level. Because of that, he was presented with the option to reset its mastery level, and when he did, the level became zero, and in turn he received 2,000 energy points. He deposited them right back into the Chimera Viper shield, but realized that he needed 4,000 more to fully upgrade it. So what he did was go through some of his lesser used shields and reset their mastery for energy in order to get the remaining 4,000 points. Every time he gave that shield some more energy, the power of its abilities would grow and its rarity would increase. At first it went from common to uncommon, and that gave a 1.2 times boost in the power of its abilities. But when it upgraded from uncommon to rare, that was when Naofumi realized that his shield had become significantly more powerful. Imbuing his shield with energy from the mastery level resets of other shields really did a solid job in increasing its overall ability power. Naofumi was ecstatic to now try Motoyasu's method, but his was very material dependent, and given all the testing that he just did, there weren't quite enough materials left to test smelting and spirit enchantments. He did, however, have enough to test status enhancement, which only gave a random effect on use anyway. By the end, Naofumi's Chimera Viper shield was looking something like this, sporting a brand new increase to its magic power. When all was said and done, he had significantly boosted his overall build and individual shields. But what was more important was that Naofumi had gained a solid understanding on how his legendary weapon worked. The system clearly responded to the beliefs he had. The help menu even adjusted itself to clearly explain the methods the other heroes had mentioned. But that didn't mean that Naofumi could just think up any progression system and use that. For now, it seemed to be limited to just those three. And if all systems worked for him, then it's likely that they worked for everyone else. The others just needed to have a little more faith in each other. Anyway, it's best to consider each system as their own type of progression, with each responsible for upgrading a unique aspect of the legendary weapons. Mastery level becomes energy that increases rarity and boosts ability power, weapon enhancements improve base stats and grant new abilities, and job level allows for individual growth while weapon rarity provides for a stronger overall weapon. And that's pretty much what each hero can do with their weapons. All they need to do is believe that these methods work and then it'll become available to them. So that's pretty much it. I guess next for Shield Hero will be more cut content. So I'll continue that in between my ReZero and Fate content that I'm doing this season, which if you haven't checked out, then you can find the links to those in the description. Anyway, as always, thank you so much for watching, and if you enjoyed this type of anime content, then you already know what to do. So until next time.